Welcome back to The Breakfast. An investigative report a few days ago shocked many Nigerians with the details and the bits of information, you know, that were released by investigative journalist David Hundeyin. It basically was exposing, you know, loads of corruption that were going on in the Nigerian Immigration Service and the reasons why Nigerians may have been struggling to get their passports in time. We're speaking this morning with that investigative journalist, David Hundeyin, who's joining us via Zoom. Good morning, and thanks for your time this morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Thanks for having me.
All right. So it must have taken you some time to put this, you know, information together, do as much research as possible. But I want us to start with you telling us the biggest findings for you in this, you know, report that you put out.
Okay, so for me, there were three major findings, and in order of importance, I would say the third most important finding was that, first of all, within the Nigerian Immigration Service, there seems to be like a whole other set of processes that the public is not aware of, processes which are not written down anyway, which sort of the people, the civil servants involved, just kind of make it up as they go along. So when you go and apply for passports, and you pay your 30,000 naira or however much it is, you don't really understand the politics going on in there and why it is that you may get your passport in a month, you might get it in a year, depending on who is handling your case, depending on what part of the country the person handling your case is from, depending on which passport office you applied at. So, for example, if you applied at the Ikoyi Passport Command, there will be a very low possibility that it will come out in a reasonable space of time. So when I spoke to people in and around the Immigration Service, I was able to ascertain that there is it's unstated, but very blatant a policy of northernization going on in the Immigration Service, which actually started under the previous Comptroller General, which has continued into this regime, where the postings that are considered to be desirable, such as Lagos and Abuja, are being given exclusively to immigration officers of northern origin, while the southern officers are being transferred out to places like Sokoto and whatnot. That was the first finding. The second finding, in order of importance, was that the company that actually prints these passports is a lot more powerful than Nigerians are aware of. This company essentially has the power to create Nigerian citizens out of thin air. This company has full control of the supply chain of Nigerian passports from end to end. So it handles the information capture, the database management, and also subcontracts the printing to a Malaysian company. And the company is so powerful that the federal government actually is not even in a position to retrieve the contract from this company, because this company essentially has made it so that, I don't know how it happened like that, that the contract that was signed made it such that the company alone has access to certain things that even the Nigerian Immigration Service is not able to carry out maintenance work on the databases of the Nigerian passport system. It's not able to carry out any basic physical maintenance on the systems. If the system goes down at any passport office, officers of the Nigerian Immigration Office literally cannot do anything about it. It's the company itself. The company is called ISTL, which has to come in and sort everything out. So the Immigration Service essentially is less powerful than this private entity that nobody has ever heard of. This private company is more powerful within the immigration space than the Nigerian Immigration Service itself. And then the most important finding was that the person who actually runs this company, the owner of this company, is someone who under no circumstances is supposed to hold such a contract which is so critical to Nigeria's national security. This person used to be a diplomat, and this person was dismissed from the diplomatic service in the early 1980s after being indicted for drug trafficking, using his diplomatic status and his diplomatic immunity to traffic drugs into the United States. So there's, I got hold of court documents from the United States District Court of New Jersey, dating back to 1979, which essentially contained a full indictment, 7-page indictment of this diplomat. His name is Olayinka Sonayan Fisher, and then also detailed the allegations against his other the other members of his drug ring, who all sort of ratted each other out And the story became very clear that this person was contacted by an American businessman called Tracy Wong, who was working with a convicted drug dealer called Anthony Marguerite. And Tracy Wong basically brought this diplomat into the operation that, look, we have millions of dollars worth of cocaine that is being trafficked from South America and Asia. I mean, we want to bring it into the U.S., but we want you to help us bring it into the U.S. because you are a diplomat, so you have diplomatic immunity. Your bags are not searched when you're traveling into the U.S. You have an opportunity to traffic drugs that most people do not. Bear in mind that this fellow was not just an ordinary diplomat. He was a very senior diplomat. He was the second secretary of Nigeria's mission to the U.N. in the mid to late 1970s. So according to court documents,
Go ahead. We can hear you.
Yeah. Okay, so according to the court documents, between for at least 2 years from 1978 onward, he was working with this drug ring and pushing millions of dollars worth of cocaine into the U.S. And for each trip, he was paid approximately $50,000 as his cut. And this person was dismissed from the service. And for whatever reason, even though he was the U.S. Had called for him to be extradited, he was shielded, he was protected by the Nigerian government for whatever reason. We can only speculate as to what reason there was. Maybe he was working with someone in the government, maybe he was working on behalf of someone, maybe he had a godfather in the government, we don't know. And he disappeared from the public eye, and then he reappeared in 2003 under President Obasanjo as the CEO of this company, ISTL. I somehow got hold of this contract. And, you know, somehow this with that kind of colorful past was awarded a contract, the sole contract, to print Nigerian passport booklets and to maintain the information database of Nigerian passport holders. So essentially, if you hold a Nigerian passport, like the Nigerian e-passport, all your details are in the hands of an indicted drug trafficker, which I found completely absurd. And the fact that the DSS, which, I mean, you and I know that in some cases, even if you're going to handle just something as simple as a road contract in Nigeria, the DSS will vet you to your third generation. So it was just very surprising to me that how is it that such a person who under no circumstances, even by the wording of the Public Procurement Act of 2007, should have been nowhere near, you know, being given this kind of public procurement contract, was cleared somehow by the security services to hold not just a public contract, but that kind of public contract with such severe implications for Nigeria's national security. So I thought that was a story that definitely needed to be told.
Okay, David, this really is explosive. Lots of allegations here. And Mr. Fisher, you mentioned, is one of three people you say had so much influence in the Nigerian Immigration Service. Tell us more about the other two people.
So the first that was mentioned was the immediate past Controller General, that is Mohammed Babandidi. And based on the conversations that I had with the sources in and around the service, Mr. Babandidi essentially was the one who, obviously, you know, without saying so explicitly, instituted the modernization policy in the Nigerian Immigration Service, whereby starting with the Koyi Passport Command specifically, which is perceived to be in the service as sort of the most desirable place to be posted in Nigeria in terms of, you know, making money, that command was essentially fully modernized. The majority of the officers of Southern Extraction working there were transferred out and replaced with Northern officers whose goal there was to make money. And this was repeated in Abuja and in sort of the more desirable postings across the country, such that in Lagos, for example, where there are three passport offices, only one of these passport offices is staffed by a Southerner, and the other two, which are staffed by Northerners, are, the passport office in Amodafe is headed by Southerner. The other two, which are headed by Northerners, are staffed almost entirely by Northerners. And this is a pattern that repeats itself across the country. That was the first part of what he was responsible for. The second thing he did was that during his tenure, the payment system for paying the wages and entitlements of Nigerian Immigration Service staff was moved to the IPPIS, which is sort of the system that handles a civil service and armed forces payments in Nigeria. However, the effect that this had was that it completely removed all transparency from the payments of the Nigerian Immigration Service system. So essentially, when I spoke to the sources, what they told me was that they don't know how much is coming into their account at the end of the month. When a new officer is hired, the new officer really doesn't actually know how much he or she is going to get paid. They simply don't know. So the deductions vary wildly from month to month. So let's say, for the sake of an example, let's say your salary is 80,000 naira. This month, the deductions might be 12,000 naira. Next month, deduction might be 27,000 naira. You have no idea what it's for, how much is going to get deducted, what is going to come into your account at the end of the month. So what this has done is that it has created this sort of ad hoc culture within the NIS where everybody's just desperately trying to make money whichever way they can, if you know, which obviously for a service whose main public facing activity is issuing passports, and obviously passports are in demand in Nigeria, are always in demand, and people are willing to pay a premium for those, so that then creates that situation where everybody is trying desperately to make money off the passport distribution process. So when there's a huge passport shortage, you know, apart from the issues with the supply chain of the passport booklet itself, the company that prints them in Malaysia having forex issues and whatnot, one of the major problems with the major reasons why Nigerians cannot access booklets, you know, in a reasonable space of time, is because there's so much arbitrage going on and there are so many hands that need to be greased because of this IPPS, this rushed IPPIS implementation, which has taken all transparency away. So everyone within the immigration service is trying to make money at the expense of Nigerians who are just trying to get their passports. So, and then the third person mentioned was Abdullahi Lehman, who is the PCO, he's a Deputy Comptroller General. He's in charge of the Ikoyi Passport Command, which, as I mentioned earlier, is one of the most important passport commands in Nigeria. Now, every source I spoke to about this fellow had very uncomplimentary things to say about him. Essentially, that this is the spearhead of modernization in Nigerian Immigration Service. That this guy didn't just ensure that most of the southerners working at the Ikoyi Passport Command were transferred out and replaced with northerners, with his kinsmen, but that he takes it to such ridiculous extents as, for example, speaking exclusively Hausa during work hours. So you're a southern immigration officer working at the passport command, you don't speak Hausa, you're at a disadvantage because he's more likely to have conversations with even your subordinates, even your juniors, in your presence, and you don't understand what they're saying. They're speaking Hausa in your presence. And that, for example, where there's a southern officer and there's a northern officer working together, maybe doing the data capture, and it's, say, it's time for a Muslim prayer or something, and the northern officer, who is obviously a Muslim, will just get up and go out and say he's going to pray, and the southern officer has to continue working, you know, essentially doing two people's work, and that this is officially sanctioned by Lima. That is how things are done at the Ikoyi Passport Command now. And that this obviously has had a predictable effect on staff morale within southern ranks, has also created the conditions for ethnic and religious conflict within the Ikoyi Passport Command of the NIS, and that he himself is his second major, you know, goal, apart from the organization of the Ikoyi Passport Command, is also to make money. So under him, there are all sorts of opaque processes which are not written down anyway, which are part of the process of issuing a passport. There are things that didn't include in the reports because they were just sort of things that the sources said, but they're very difficult to independently confirm. But essentially, when you simply walk into the Ikoyi Passport Command and you do your data capture and you pay your money and you expect your passport to come out within, let's say, a month, that you really don't know what is going on because there's an entire network of palms that need to be greased. There are sort of ad hoc processes that have been instituted which are not part of the official stated process anywhere, which Abdullahi Lehman has sort of put in place with the sole express intention of making money and making money for his cronies, so to speak. And that This has destroyed staff morale. This has made it even harder for people to access passports. The Ikoyi Passport Command has the largest backlog of passport production in the country. And funnily enough, I'll just quickly mention this before I go back to you. Funnily enough, almost as soon as the story came into the public domain, came into the public space, the new Comptroller General of Immigration, that's Idris Jerry, immediately ordered a task force to be deployed to the Ikoyi Passport Command to deal with its backlog. Because I'm sure even within the Immigration Service, it was quite well known that under Lehman's leadership, the Ikoyi Passport Command had a huge and unjustifiable backlog. And for the purposes of optics, it was expedient to do something about that now. There were also, from my sources within the NIS, Abdullahi Lehman has also been summoned to Abuja. He has been issued a query and has been summoned to appear for his boss. So we wait and see what the outcome of that will be.
Well, I there's so much, you know, to unpack from all of this, you know, and I've heard people complain many times, you know, that online, you know, to get a Nigerian passport is about 13,000 or 17,000, but when you go to the office, you end up paying as much as 45,000 or 50,000 naira, if you hope to get it, you know, and nobody has ever been able to understand why it is that high. And, you know, if you speak with them, they tell you they need to buy diesel, they need to settle here, they need to, you know, just many frivolous excuses. But that has gone on for a long time. And I'm sure it makes you wonder how much really gets back to the government compared to how much gets into pockets. And the millions and maybe even billions of naira that is made in that office that never gets back to government coffers. But that's an angle, you know, on its own. Now, I want you to speak more on the discussion on Olayinka Fisher and how his position may be dangerous to the Nigerian, you know, to Nigeria itself and those who have their information with ISTL. Why is this a problem that he is, of course, the head of ISTL and he has access to this information?
Right, so it's important to know that ISTL itself doesn't actually print passport booklets. So it's affiliated with a Malaysian company called Iris Corp, which actually does the printing. They do security printing, not just for Nigeria, but for a number of African jurisdictions as well.
Yeah.
So they do things like printing passport booklets, printing currency bills, that sort of thing. Now, ISTL essentially is, to all intents and purposes, a tech support company, because they don't actually have any sort of physical products. What they do is essentially database management and equipment management on behalf of the NIS. Now, essentially, what this contract with ISTL does is that it makes it near impossible for the Immigration Service to actually wield control over the data that you and I submit when we go to the office, your biometric data, your bio data, all those things. The database those things are saved in is an ISTL database. Now, the database has been, and the equipment were paid for by the federal government. They're not paid for with private funds. They're paid for with public funds, right? But the total control over the database and the equipment that makes the database possible is vested in ISTL. So essentially, the government is subservient to this private entity which it gave a contract to. So essentially, the day that ISTL decides that something isn't going to work, it's not going to work, and the NIS can do nothing about it. And to just give an example of this, in 2017, the initial contract was awarded in 2007 for 10 years. 2017, when the contract ran out, there was a huge furore because people within the NIS at the senior levels were grumbling that this contract should not be renewed, this contract is bad for national security, this contract gives too much power to ISTL. And there were indications that there was a power tussle between ISTL and people who wanted the contract taken away. Obviously, the people who wanted the contract taken away were not necessarily doing so for altruistic purposes. They probably had their own interests that they were trying to serve. According to what I hear, some of them had their own companies that they wanted to use to replace ISTL, not necessarily to change status quo. But putting that aside, in 2019, all of a sudden, we just heard that the contract has been renewed after the matter dragged on for 2 years. Why was it renewed? Essentially because the Nigerian government didn't have a choice. ISTL has the Nigerian government with its hands tied behind its back. If ISTL decides that, okay, you want to pull out, fine, we'll cut out everything. There's nothing Nigerian government can actually do. The database is fully vested in ISTL, and worse than that, there's a government seal which essentially makes a Nigerian e-passport valid, right? And the control of that seal is with ISTL. It's, again, not with the Immigration Service. So ISTL has the power to essentially create a Nigerian citizen out of thin air. And I have a very big problem with that, because essentially what that means is that this company, which is run by a drug trafficker who used to use his diplomatic status to traffic, you know, drugs across borders into jurisdictions like the US, now has the power to create passports, to create Nigerian citizens. So, you know, it doesn't take much imagination to think about the implications of that. So what has this power been used to do over the past, you know, 15 years that we are not aware of? You know, I obviously don't want to speculate on national TV, but I mean, it doesn't take a lot of imagination to see where my line of inquiry is headed. And then the Malaysian company that prints these booklets, Iris Corp, has actually the executive leadership of that company, specifically the CEO, has been arrested as recently as 2017 on corruption charges in Malaysia with regard to the bidding process for the e-passport contract by Guinea, the West African country of Guinea. So essentially you have this Malaysian company which has been implicated even by its own government for corrupt dealings with regards to how it obtained the e-passport contract to print e-passports for Guinea. That company has the sole, you know, the sole ability to print passport booklets for Nigerians, right? And then this company is a subcontractor working on behalf of ISTL. So ISTL subcontracts printing, which it was awarded to this Malaysian company. And then to get that done, ISTL has to pay the Malaysian company in USD, in hard currency, right? Now, it just so happens that, obviously, since 2016, the value of the Naira has more than halved in relation to the US dollar. So it has made paying ISTL over twice as expensive as it used to be. So essentially, and the income that ISTL relies on, which obviously comes from Nigerians applying for passports, comes in Naira. So in Naira terms, its income has remained roughly the same. In dollar terms, its income has more than has halved, basically. So it can't afford to pay for printing of as many booklets as it used to. So now the fight is with the CBN, that the CBN should provide Forex to ISTL at the CBN rate, at the subsidized CBN rate. And the CBN says, no way, we're not going to do that. That's the CBN under Godwin Emefiele. And so ISTL is forced to source for Forex from the parallel market, which, as we know, is, you know, touching 600 Naira to a dollar now. So what that means is that it's almost impossible for, you know, given its current Naira income, which hasn't changed, it's almost impossible for there to be sufficient passport booklets for Nigerians, because it has to pay the Malaysian company USD. Now, my question is, the security printing process. Yes, we know that these materials, these security printing materials, are not produced in Nigeria currently. We know that the technology to produce these booklets in Nigeria currently doesn't exist in Nigeria. But given that this is an administration which has paid so much lip service to local production and, you know, easing pressure on Forex demand by import substitution, all these kinds of things. So shouldn't there have been some kind of a move to obtain that technology and to make it possible to print those booklets in Nigeria? Because even from a national security point of view, I find it very hard to accept that a country of, you know, allegedly 180 or 200 million people has to, you know, contract the printing of passport booklets for its citizens.
Foreign company or country. Indeed, David Udeyi, we do understand that. Well, we'll dig more into this and find out, you know, in future, what exactly the government of Nigeria is saying, if they can justify contracting this to a company that is now facing corruption charges in Malaysia, and how Mr. Fisher, you know, scaled through the cracks to make it to such a sensitive position in the country. We'll be following up with you for more details, David Udeyi. Thank you very much for joining us on The Breakfast.
Thank you for having me.
Next up, we'll be talking about the North rejection of the power shift for 2023 and their stance on the VAT controversy after the break. Stay with us.